Parkinson's disease occurs in elderly. It is noted to be 1% in the population over the age of 60. It's associated with tremor, muscle rigidity, bradykinesia, and akinesia, difficulty with muscle motion. Akinesia is the loss of normal automatic motion, such as eye blinking, swallowing. So patients can drool and have a decreased arm swing with walking. Many patients will have a pill rolling maneuver at rest. Motor strength will be normal even though the motion is slow, and 75% of patients may have unilateral symptoms. There is rest tremor present, that is the pill rolling, but the voice tremor typically does not occur, and there is a typical gait called a festination gait. The patient tends to take short steps with the upper body traveling faster than the lower body, and a walk will typically turn into a run in advanced diseases. Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease is an inherited disease of peripheral nerves. There's actually a number of different types. It's also called peroneal muscle atrophy. The myelin sheath and the nerve itself are both affected, and it's both motor and sensory. The hallmark of this disease is a cavovarus foot, a fancy way of saying a very high arch, turned-in foot with arched toes. The picture on the side is significant for this. Some individuals have a, quote, stork leg appearance, unquote, where they have lower leg muscle atrophy, but the upper muscles in the thighs are still intact. 10% of patients with Charcot-Marie-Tooth will have a spinal deformity, and intrinsic muscles of the hand can also be involved. Lyme disease. Lyme disease is an infectious neurologic disease caused by the bite of the deer tick. This deer tick will carry the bacteria Borrelia burgdorferi, which is a spirochete. The onset from the tick bite is about 3 to 32 days, and 80% of patients will experience a rash called an erythema migrans. What they'll see is a small central erythematous macule or papule that spreads into a large red ring with central clearing called a target lesion, seen on the lady on the right. The symptoms will initially be headaches, fever, chills, myalgias, and fatigue. And 15% of these patients will develop frank nerve abnormalities, such as meningitis, encephalitis, cranial neuritis, such as Bell's palsy, aplexitis, or mononeuritis multiplex, individual nerves which all become involved. In months to years later, the patient can develop chronic nerve manifestations, which include mood, memory, sleep patterns, spinal and even radicular pain, and 8% will develop cardiac manifestations. The treatment is doxycycline and erythromycin if caught early. Guillain-Barre syndrome is called ascending paralysis. It's an autoimmune disorder associated with myelin destruction. Onset can be days or weeks after a viral prodrome. It starts always in the foot, it works up the leg, and then ascends up the spine. The ascent can take 2 to 3 weeks, but some aggressive cases have been noted to see 3 to 4 hours of ascent. The mildest form of Guillain-Barre is simple fatigue and typically won't be recognized. When the ascent goes to the diaphragm, life support is necessary, and the effects typically disappear within months, but 15% of patients can have lasting impairment. Herpes zoster. As most people know, herpes zoster or shingles is the varicella virus or the chickenpox virus. If a patient hasn't had chickenpox, they won't develop herpes zoster. The virus typically lies dormant in the spinal dorsal root ganglion, and for some reason, an unknown stressor will activate the virus. The first symptoms are unilateral pain down the dermatome of the nerve, and 2 to 3 days later, a rash will develop. These are small, reddish, fluid-filled blisters called vesicles. The rash increases from onset for 3 days and then dries up, and small scars can permanently form. there is a very painful condition that can occur to an injured nerve called postherpetic neuralgia, which is painful scarring of a nerve and a permanent painful condition. If steroids are given during the beginning of the attack, this will typically prevent nerve scarring. Parsonage-Turner syndrome is a brachial plexopathy, an involvement of the lower motor neurons of the brachial plexus. It will be an onset somewhat similar to a herniated disc in the neck. It's one-sided or unilateral shoulder pain, which is severe and crescendos in a day or two. It's associated with significant weakness of the shoulder and the upper extremities. The paralysis can last months to a year, and typically there's full recovery in about 75%, but this is prolonged. Males are noted to be much more common than females at 2 to 1 to 4 to 1. The diagnosis is made by exclusion and an EMG. As this is a plexopathy, an EMG should not show any involvement of the paravertebral muscles. Autoimmune vertebral involvement, or the spondyloarthropathies. Most of these disorders start with the sacroiliac joint involvement, except for rheumatoid arthritis and lupus. Most are unilateral SI involvement, except ankylosing spondylitis, which is typically bilateral involvement. Stiffness in the morning that gets better with motion is a typical harbinger of the autoimmune vertebral involvement. Fatigue is also very common. The types of spondyloarthropathies are rheumatoid arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, ulcerative colitis, Crohn's, Reiter syndrome, ankylosing spondylitis, and lupus. DISH is diffuse idiopathic skeletal hyperostosis, or Forestier's disease. This is a typically non-painful disease and associated with diabetes. 10% of patients with diabetes will have this disease. It's characterized by these non-marginal, very large syndesmophytes where the spine starts becoming stiff and the spine can eventually fuse together. Unilateral SI involvement, as noted before, are typically the seronegative spondyloarthropathies. Seronegative because the serum is negative. There is no HLA-B27 here. And again, noted ulcerative colitis and Crohn's, psoriatic arthritis, Reiter syndrome, but not ankylosing spondylitis, as there is bilateral involvement. In this CT scan, we can see the right SI joint is not involved and the left SI joint is fused, indicating a unilateral SI involvement or a seronegative spondyloarthropathy. Seronegative spondyloarthropathies develop non-marginal syndesmophytes. These are spurs that join the vertebra together that are not right on the margin. They actually swing out here. Marginal syndesmophytes that go right edge to edge are typical with ankylosing spondylitis. And again, these diseases have sacroiliac involvement, fatigue and lethargy, and typically not common HLA-B27, but they can have that. This is compared to ankylosing spondylitis, the prototype for these diseases. It first starts with bilateral sacroiliac joint involvement. The incidence is considered to be 1 in 1,000 patients. There's periods of remission and aggravation. It's typical to have back pain that wakes the patient up at night, morning stiffness that is relieved with exercise, anterior uveitis, and unlike the others, marginal syndesmophytes. It's typically called a bamboo spine, and 95% of patients are positive for HLA-B27. It's also typical to have a kyphosis, and as we can see, this patient is bent forward with a fused spine, and we look at the brow-chin angle. Ankylosing spondylitis starts on x-rays with an initial squaring of the vertebra. As you can see here, the vertebra should typically be cupped, but they start to square, and marginal syndesmophytes are the most common findings. Physical exam findings in ankylosing spondylitis will first be noted with chest excursion. If you measure inspiration and expiration of the chest, they will be much more limited than normal. Reduction or absence of normal lumbar range of motion can also be associated with this.